First, I want to thank all of you for your help with me on this journey. Before I begin individually on thanking some people, I want to name someone who's not here in the chamber with us. He used to sit right here, right over there. Former Senator Tom Duane, who carried this bill for 6 years. And when he left the Senate, he asked me if I would pick it up because he knew I had an interest in it, because when I first got here and he was carrying the bill, I agreed to co-sponsor it. And we had a discussion at the time about why I thought medical marijuana was the right thing for New York State. And I shared the experience I had with both of my parents, who unfortunately died very young from lung cancer. And I watched them suffer, just like so many people have watched members of their family suffer. And during that period of time, I realized that for my mother, for my father, for my grandfather as well, they had one of two choices. They could suffer, or they could continue to be prescribed seriously addictive narcotics, which at that point in their life, it really didn't matter. They just needed relief. But it didn't really provide relief. For most of them, particularly my grandfather, all it did was rob him of whatever time he had left because he was in a sedative state for the remaining months of his life. He didn't want to live like that, but he had no choice. That's what happens to so many people right now, because in our state, if you are suffering from any of the conditions that could be covered by this bill, you have a choice. You can suffer, or you can become dependent upon highly addictive, dangerous drugs that oftentimes don't work. They don't really provide the relief, but yet we don't have any choice. I've listened a lot today to this debate, and I just want to make a few points about some of the concerns that some of you still have, and I share them as well. If the FDA, Senator Hannon, would finally act, we wouldn't be doing this here in New York State or in state houses across the country. The FDA would reschedule marijuana, and it would go through U.S. studies, and we would be able to have a comprehensive program across the country, but they've refused to do that. But, you know, we're an amazing nation where we have one of the best healthcare systems in the world. But we are not the only country in the world. And we are not the only place where they have amazing healthcare delivery systems. This product, medical marijuana, has been studied extensively all over the world. We can look to our northern neighbor, Canada. They have research studies. They understand the value of medical marijuana and how it can be prescribed and how it provides relief. Go to Ireland. They've done it there. Israel. The United Kingdom. We have met a body of medical evidence to support this, which is why there are so many physicians' organizations that support this. Whether they be the Epilepsy Foundation or oncologists, there are doctors who rely on that medical training and research that's been done in other places. But if you want to look locally, we have 22, we will be the 23rd state, there are 22 other states that have been utilizing medical marijuana. Some of them as far back as 1996. Alaska adopted a medical marijuana statute in 1998. We could look to Alaska. We could look to Colorado. We could look to Connecticut. We could look to New Mexico. We could look to any of them where they have developed protocols and physicians have been prescribing marijuana for medicinal purposes. So we can take comfort from that. But yes, it would be better if the FDA would finally act. By the way, the same FDA that has rubber stamped some of the most dangerous drugs that we have ever dealt with in our history. So the FDA doesn't always provide us the comfort that we need. Again, I wish we could do this sooner for Oliver, for Mabel, for everyone. But it does take time to get a system like this up and running. And hopefully within that 18-month period of time, we will all be able to have some input on it. And we can bring Mabel back home, and we can provide relief for Oliver, and we will not be able to provide a cure for people with these conditions. I'm very aware of that. What we can provide, though, is treatment, options, and relief for patients, and the ability of patients and their doctors to make those decisions for themselves. That's what today is about. I want to thank a few people, though, before I sit. I know we have been at this a long time, and I really want to thank each and every one of you. I know that I can be somewhat persuasive, I think Senator Klein pointed out. I've seen some of you run away from me. But when I caught you, you still were respectful and you listened. And more importantly, I listened. When I picked up this bill from Tom Duane, it was a very, very different piece of legislation. And it's been a very different piece of legislation since I reintroduced it at the beginning of this year. And a lot of those changes came about because I had the opportunity to talk to each and every one of you, even those of you who are still voting no on the bill. I sought your input, I listened to your concerns, and I tried to find a way to address them in the legislation. I believe that is what we're supposed to do with huge pieces of public policy like this. So even if you don't vote for it today, you still had input on this bill. You can still proudly say that you helped this bill become the strongest, most regulated medical marijuana statute in the country, and you can partially take credit for the relief that's going to be extended to patients, even if you vote no, because I listened to you. And I was able to work with Dick Gottfried, who, by the way, is an amazing individual. I had the pleasure of working on this bill with Dick Gottfried, who's been carrying it for 18 years. We would never have gotten where we were if not for his diligence. I would not be where we are tonight or this afternoon if someone else in this chamber didn't have the guts to be the deciding vote to move the bill out of the Health Committee, and that is Senator Bill Larkin. Senator Klein, I'm sure everyone here can imagine how grateful I am to you for your leadership in more ways than one. Senator Skelos, thank you for putting up with our demand that this come to the floor, and I'm so happy that you're voting for it now because I know I was a pest. Senator Stewart Cousins, for showing the leadership in your conference. We would not be passing this bill if they hadn't already been signed on to the bill from the very beginning. There are a few other people I just have to mention that have been involved in this process, starting first and foremost with my staff. Barbara O'Neill is behind me, but Brian Clenahan, my counsel, has really done the most amazing job on this bill. All of our staff, John Emmerich, the chief of staff to the IDC, had to put up with me every day, and I think he's probably going to qualify under the post-traumatic stress portion of the bill at some point in the future. Lisa Reed and Pat McCarthy, Vince Marone, Jess Shafroth, Artie Malkin, Gabriel Sayer, Julie Netherland, Liz Hamlin. They helped us every day work this bill through both houses. And as a result of their tireless efforts, we are here at this moment where we are finally going to make New York State the next state to have medical marijuana available to the patients. And finally, to the patients, to the families, to the mothers, to everyone, thank you. We would not be here if not for you and your willingness to travel. And this was not easy for you. To be here on a weekly basis, to meet with members, to just continue to press the case for your family members. You are the reason we're here today. You are what this bill is all about. Thank you.